I think we can start. Hello, everybody. Welcome to this edition of YAC Colloquium. I'm happy to. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Oh, okay, I'm sorry. I'm happy to present today's speaker, Paolo Soffitta. Paolo, I briefly summarize here his career. He started very early working in X-ray polarimetry applied to astrophysics from its degree thesis and its PhD thesis. He taken his PhD in 1977. And in the 90s, he participated also in the implementation and calibration of stellar X-ray polarimetry. That was a mission that was never launched because of the collapse of the Soviet Union. And then he spends a lot of periods abroad as a visiting research scientist in the Columbia University with the Robert Novick's group. And after the launch of BepoSat in 1960, Paolo participated in the exploitation of scientific data with the analysis of X-ray counterpart gamma ray bursts with wide field cameras. In 2000s, he participated also in the calibration and implementation and design of Super Agile, the X-ray monitor onboard Agile gamma ray mission that is still in operation and was launched in 2007. In parallel, he continues to work with X-ray polarimetry with Enrico Costa. And together they have developed the idea of exploiting the photoelectric effect in X-ray polarimetry and applying it to astrophysics. This study has been developed in collaboration with the Ronaldo Bellazzini Group in the INFN of Pisa INFN. And then, after a lot of period of failed attempts, now he succeed to launch this mission and the XP mission that is totally dedicated to X-ray polarimetry. And the mission was built in collaboration with NASA and ASI. Paolo is the Italian principal investigator, and so I'm happy to let the floor to Paolo that will speak about XP. Paolo, it's your turn.
Thank you very much, Fiamma. The Imaging X-ray Polarimetry Explorer. We always thought that X-ray polarimetry is an important tool in X-ray astronomy because the emission process themselves, like cyclotron, synchrotron, and thermal bremsstrahlung, provide polarized radiation, but also if the radiation is emitted thermally, therefore intrinsically not polarized, they can assume a certain degree of polarization by scattering on a spherical accreting plasma, like disk, blobs, and column. Also, vacuum polarization and birefringence through extreme magnetic field can be probable by X-ray polarimetry. In order to measure polarization, we usually curve, that is the histogram of a direction with respect to the angle of polarization. And from the modulated term, we derive the polarization of the source. From the flat term, we derive from the position of the peaks, we derive the polarization angle. This formalism includes the fitting with the cosine square function that is completely equivalent by using Stokes parameters in which it's possible to study a modulation curve by using the usual information that are typical of other wavelengths. The important parameter to be taken into account is the minimum detectable polarization, the MDP, in which actually is the level at which it's possible to exclude the hypothesis of absence of polarization at the 99% confidence level. And Since we want to try to measure polarization of the order 1%, with a modulation factor that is the key parameter of a polarimeter that is zero if the detector is not sensitive to polarization, this one is maximally sensitive to polarization, we end up with more than 700,000 counts to measure a polarization of 1%. That is a much larger number of counts that are needed for measuring a spectral slope on to detect a source. So a polarimetry is photon starving and deserves a dedicated instrument. The first experiment to be flown was soon after the discovery of the first extrasolar source in 1962 with the polarization based on Thomson scattering or rocket that were able only to measure upper limit with a very large upper limit on SCOIX-1 and the Crab Nebula. However, in 71, it was built by the group of Columbia, a rocket that with the Bragg diffraction technique measured albeit with a low significance the polarization of the Crab Nebula. The experience of this rocket brought to the construction of OSO-8 polarimeter, that is a graphite crystal polarimeter on parabolic surface. Parabolic surface allow to increase the signals to noise ratio, so to increase the sensitivity. And OSO-8 was able to measure a polarization of 19% with the 19 sigma of significance. As you can see in the central panel, the modulation curve measured by OSO-8 for the Crab. This is a very precise measurement that was done, the unique measurement until very recently. Also, other OSO-8 results were upper limit on the Crab pulsar emission, the precision zero X-ray polarization determination from SCOIX-1, and the low significant polarization measurement of Cygnus X-1, and also other upper limit, very coarse, so not useful to constrain the models. Ariel 5 also mounted a spectrometer that could have acted as a polarimeter, but he had a flat crystal. Flat crystal means a large detector to collect the photons. Indeed, with respect to OSO-8, it was not possible to measure any polarization at the level of even for SCOIX-1, that is a very bright source. The Thomson scattering technique and the Bragg diffraction technique were placed at the focus were designed to be placed at the focus of a telescope for the former Spectrum X Gamma mission. The graphite crystal made a secondary focus on a detector sensitive to polarization, while the underneath lithium scatter will do the job of making Thomson scattering on this detector. However, this mission that was completely devised, built, calibrated, were never flown for the collapse of the Soviet Union. We actually tried to measure polarization during with photoelectric effect, and this was a result of an error that was made during the time of SXRP between 1 and 10 kV. For which actually the X-ray sources are bright and the mirrors are very effective. And so it's possible to arrive to have a very large number of counts for arriving to the desired sensitivity. Also, this is the classical energy band of X-ray astronomy. So sounds expectations of polarization from source are possible, and so is very possible to design a mission that is capable to measure polarization from celestial sources. the photoelectric effect is such that a photon impinging of an atom interacted with the s and s electron. The s electron is brings memory of the polarization of the coming beam because it's preferentially ejected along the polarization vector of the coming beam. And by measuring the distribution in space of Cachet photoelectrons after absorption of a polarized photon beam, it's possible to derive the polarization. The first tentative to measure polarization below 10 keV was done in collaboration with the Istituto Nazionale of Fisica Nucleare of Pisa by using a micro gap detector that is a monodimensional detector. That was the first time that the polarization sensitivity was detected below 10 keV with the photoelectric effect. And the practical implementation of photoelectric effect, the modern one, is the gas pixel detector. That is actually a gas cell with a beryllium window on a side, a pixelated anode on the opposite side, and there is a gas electron multiplier in green that is the multiplication plane that multiply the charge produced by a photon that produce a track due to the interaction of the photoelectron with the gas, and the photoelectrons drift toward the gem and gets amplified and eventually collected by a pixelated anode that is an ASIC CMOS chip that is built at the same and is capable to reconstruct the shape of the track by selecting a region of interest around the track. There are 100,000 pixels, 50 micron pitch, and is an analog device, so it contains the charge, it detects the charge in each pixel. We deal with tracks, and by using the third three moment of the analysis of the track, that is the mean, the second moment and the third moment, is possible to derive the conversion point that is related to imaging, the emission direction that is related to polarization. We can count the charge in each pixel, sum the charge and get an information on the energy. And also we have a trigger output that allows to do to measure the time of which the charge is collected by the device. These are the capability of the gas pixel detector. The top left, you see the modulation curve. On the bottom left, you see the image of a source. In the top right, there are the signals that are available by the gas pixel detector with the trigger output. And in the bottom right, the behavior of the energy resolution as a function of energy for the gas pixel detector. These are the detector properties, sensitive area of 15 millimeter by 15 millimeter. The composition and the fill gas is dimethylether of 0.8 atmosphere at the time of filling. The detector window is 50 micron thick beryllium window. The absorption and the drift region depth is 10 millimeter. The gem is a liquid crystal polarimeter polymer plated with the copper on both sides, with a gem or pitch of 50 micron in triangular lattice. This device was flown already in 2019 in a different configuration with respect to the one for XP, but was flown on board on a CubeSat and made the detection, redetection, albeit with low significance, of a soft X-ray polarization from the CRAB, and the detection also with low significance of polarization from SCOX-1. In 2001, we developed instead a technique that was the heart of the heart of the missions that were devised since the beginning of 80s. Basically, we have 12 missions that was in which we tried to exploit polarization to understand the behavior of X-ray sources. Most of them are were using photoelectric effect to measure polarization, and most of them have an Italian PI, that is the recognition that this technique is fully understood and exploited in Italy. At the 13th times in 2017, XPE was selected by NASA to be the mission for being launched in 2021. This is the XPE team. The PI is Martin Weisskopf of Marshall Space Flight Center. At Marshall Space Flight Center, there is the project management, the fabrication of the mirror modules, the X-ray calibration, the science operation center, that which there is the flight pipeline that process the data, the flight data, and also Marshall Space Flight Center oversees a dual program. ASI is the agency that funds the detector system, provide the ground station. It has a key role in developing the flight pipeline by means of the SSDC, with a great job in making possible to perform the flight pipeline. BOL is the spacecraft, is the company that provides the spacecraft and the payload structure. It also performs the integration and test. The institutions that provide the calibration, the polarization sensitive detectors, calibrate the systems, are INAF, INFN, with the collaboration of HBI Italy as an industrial partner. The Mission Operations Center is at LASP of University of Colorado. Scientific Theory is in Roma 3 and Stanford University. Roma 3 is also involved in managing the science the advisory team that I will speak slide below. Nagoya University provides the thermal shield, while Massachusetts Institute of Technology provides the co-investigator. There are more than 100 scientists over 12 countries. These are the scientific requirements of XPE. The sensitivity is set in order to arrive to measure polarization also for the bright extragalactic sources. So it's about 5.5% in the 228 kV energy band at a level of 10 to the minus 11 erg per second per centimeter square in 10 days of observation. The systematic error in polarization degree has to be kept small in order to arrive to measure polarization of the order of 1%, so it's better than 0.3%. The systematic error in determining the position angle of a source should be better than 1 degree. The energy band is between 2 and 8 kV. The energy resolution is set in order to be able to study energy dependent phenomena, but also to assign the correct modulation factor to the energy of the photon. It should be better than 20% at 6 kV. The angular resolution should be better than 30 seconds in order to separate the torus of the Crab Nebula with respect to the central pulsar. The field of view should be also larger than 9 arc minutes in order to make with a single measurement the measurement of young supernova remnants. And also, timing accuracy should be kept small to do a phase-dependent analysis of polarization, and also the background should be smaller than 4 to the -3 counts per second per centimeter square. When we designed the XP, we designed the XP to be included in a Pegasus launcher. That is a launcher that was supposed to be flown on the wings of an airplane. However, this launcher has very limited mass in terms of weight and volume. So we had to take a lot of attention in design the mission to cope with this launcher, paying attention to each single gram and each single centimeter cubes to be used. However, when there was the tender to select the launcher, eventually Falcon 9 was selected, so XP was placed in the Falcon 9 fairing with a lot of space available in the fairing. This is XP deployed. There are three mirror modules with an X-ray shields that prevent X-rays coming from the side to arrive to the three detector units that are on the opposite side of the mirrors. The focal length is 4 meter, and the total length is 5.2 meter. There are two star tracker, one on forward star tracker and the other one in the bottom star tracker on the spacecraft. This is the observatory on the left, stowed at the ball. On the right, the observatory after deploying at ball. Of course, the deployment of the ball was performed many times in order to check that it would have been successful once in orbit. On the left, you see the launch of XP that was done at Kennedy Space Center in 9 December 2021. On the right, instead, you see the first stage of Falcon 9 coming back after releasing the second stage that put XP in orbit. This is the moment in which XP was released by the second stage in the orbit that is 600 kilometers, zero degree. In order to the equatorial orbit is extremely important because it allows to have low and constant background and allows to use Malindi ground station for downloading the data. The optics are produced as a standard replica electroformed nickel shell, so the substrate is nickel cobalt, and this allows to actually have a good effective area in the energy range of XP. These are the optics. On the left, you see the method that is used to make the assembly of each mirror shell. You know that in X-ray astronomy, the focusing telescope have a grazing incidence, so there are nested shells. And you see on the central part, the spider onto which there are placed and glued the shells. And on the right, the three optics at facility at Marshall Space Flight Center. The Marshall Space Flight Center Stellae test facility was used for calibrating the optics. and the facility is 100 meter length long. It's not the Chandra facility of 500 meters because the angular resolution or XP is smaller than is worse than Chandra, so it's sufficient the 100 meter test facility at Marshall. These are the properties of the optics. There are 24 mirror shells per module, three modules, and the total length is 600 millimeters. The inner and the outer shell thickness is very small. It's the thinner shells that were ever built by Marshall Space Flight Center. And this is because the weight should be kept very small because of the design for the Pegasus launcher. The effective area is quite constant between 3 and 6 kV of about 200 centimeters square. And with the field of view is limited by the detector and that 4 meter focal length is 13 arc minute. The angular resolution of the optics were different between the three of them. The detector, the mirror module assembly number one was 19 arc second, while the mirror module number two and number three were 25 arc second. However, when convolved this half power diameter with the inclined penetration of the beam and the position resolution of the detector, the system level performance is 30 arc second half power diameter. The XP instrument is composed instead of three detector units, read by detector service unit. That is, detector service unit is the instrument computer that manages the detector unit that was integrated and operated at ENAF EAPS. These are the three detector units on the top deck of the spacecraft at Ball after the integration. And these are the requirements that descend from the to the requirements of the top level requirements at the level of observatory to arrive to the desired sensitivity and desired modulation, especially a small modulation. The detector unit is on the left, is composed by on the top by a carbon 5 coated with molybdenum and gold collimator that allows to prevent X-rays from the side arrive to the detector. The top box is host the gas pixel detector and the filter and calibration wheel. The bottom box instead host the IHV board and the backend electronic board that manage the detector unit, that manage the ASIC. An important device that has been developed, the design developed at ENAF is the filter and calibration set that allows to do calibration in orbit. In orbit, we have a filter and calibration wheel that host calibration sources. These calibration sources are made by four sources. One of sources is double in the sense that provides polarized radiation at 2.9 kV and 5.9 kV. So it allows to check the performance of the detector during the orbit, during the operative life of XP. And the other three calibration sources are for gain measurement and for checking the absence of spurious polarization. There is a source made of fluorescence by silicon to 1.7 kV to have a good leverage for calibrating the gain of XP. These are the filter calibration wheel assembly. In addition to the calibration source, there is an attenuator that can be used to absorb photons from very bright sources, more than 4 crabs, that could be in this way observed by IXP with manageable dead time and the closed position to gather the background. This is the EAPS facility that provided polarized and unpolarized X-rays. It was very busy because at a certain time of the project, the facility was hosting all the detector units for flight, one in calibration and the others in the integration with the detector service unit. And the source are polarized by means of break diffraction of lines from X-ray tubes from 1.6 to 17 kV and with break angle very close to 45 degrees, so very close to 100% polarization. By using fluorescence target, it was possible to measure nearly unpolarized radiation that allowed to study the very important characteristic of the gas pixel data, that is the level of absence of spurious modulation at in the energy band. It's quite easy to build polarized radiation. It's much more difficult to build unpolarized radiation. For this reason, in order to measure the spurious modulation, we rotated the detector 90 degrees to decouple the intrinsic response to unpolarized radiation. The calibration was made in 40 days per each detector unit, 7 days a week, 24 hours a day, and most of the time was devoted to measure the spurious modulation and polarization, of course, the modulation factor, and also the other characteristic that allow to know very well the response of the detector. This is the modulation factor as a function of energy. For the four detector unit, the modulation factor was found very similar one to the other. That is very good. And as you can see, it increases with energy. And this is due to the fact that the larger is the energy, the longer is the track, the easier is to derive the emission direction of the photoelectrons. Also, the error in measuring the polarization angle is below the requirement at 6.4 kV. This is the effective area and the effective area multiplied by the modulation factor of IXP for free detector. As you can see, the maximum of the sensitivity is about 3 kV. And one word just saying that the spurious modulation was found below 6 kV, and it was studied in great details by trying to minimize it and to understand the cause. There is a correlation with the gain variation across the gem, but it was not completely understood at 100%. So we calibrated the spurious modulation at a very high degree of precision, and we checked that there was no change with temperature, no change with time, no change with the gain. The spurious modulation is subtracted on event by event base by the flight pipeline, so it's not visible to the user. And in order to do this, the high level data do not contain the firm formation and the emission direction of the photoelectrons. And however, to facilitate the calibration of the spurious modulation, we deterred the observation on a 3 arc minute diameter. That is that the The spacecraft is not stared at the source point, but it oscillates with a known pattern in order to distribute the photons across about 3 millimeters for a point source diameter in the detector. And this allow to reduce the time of calibration time because we can calibrate in a circular region and not having the statistics point by point. These are the spurious modulation that has been measured by U2, U3, and U4. And we clock the detector at 120 degrees. The clocking of the detector at 120 degrees allows to check for a truly polarized source because in sky coordinate, the spurious in sky coordinate, the spurious modulation shouldn't give any effect. We should see the same polarization in sky coordinates by the three detector unit. While for spurious effect, we should see a variation of the polarization with respect to the view under observation. At the Marshall Space Flight Center, we end up of calibrating the telescope we calibrated only the spare telescope, the spare detector unit, and the spare mirror. It was built for this also a polarized box to provide polarized X-rays and unpolarized X-rays by rotating also here the 90 degrees the source to have an unpolarized source. And the results that you can see here shows that the modulation factor measured at Marshall Space Flight Center and the of the telescope, the modulation factor measured at EAPS well match. This shows that as it was for us already for a scene, the optics don't introduce any additional modulation to the source. And also if you measure in the spurious modulation at Marshall Space Flight Center, compare it with the spurious modulation measured at IFS, we have basically the same results. This means the mirror does not introduce additional spurious modulation. So we can fully exploit the ground calibration for determine the flight performance of the three telescopes. These are the instrument performance that are matching the requirement for all except for the efficiency. We found that the efficiency was smaller than was measured that was in the requirement. This is because we discovered an absorption of the gas mixture by some element of the gas pixel detector, absorption that away anyway stabilize at the time of flight, so reducing the efficiency by about 15% with respect to the efficiency at the filling of the detector. These are the performance of XPE that I showed before. And the science team is composed by investigators that are the co-eye of the co-eye of the mission. The collaborators that are scientists that fully participate to the work on the topical work of the topical working groups, and a participant that are usually students, postdoc that have that work under the supervision of collaborators. The collaborators in Italy are very large, are more than three times the collaborator of United States. There are 12 countries involved in and XP. In order to cope with science, we set up topical working groups for different class of sources, like pulsar with nebula and isolated pulsar, supernova remnants, accreting stellar mass black hole, accreting neutron star and white dwarf, magnetars, radio quiet AGN and Sagittarius star, blazar and radio galaxies. And the first year observation regards 33 planet target plus 36 days for six transients or other targets of opportunity, because the target of opportunity program is available since the 1st of April. This is the first light of XPED. It was the image of Cassei that was measured by a single observation of because the field of view of XPED encompass all the remnant. And in for XPED we want to actually put the polarimetry at the same level of the other wavelength. Indeed, for example, for the Crab Nebula, we have detailed polarization map in radio, in infrared, and in optical, while in X-rays we have only the measurement of polarization at 19% integrated over the entire nebula. And with XP, we want to be able to measure polarization of all the most important feature of CRAB, like the jet, the torus, the arcs, and arriving to measure the polarization of the pulsar. For accreting neutron star, we want to disentangle the emission process themselves, like accreting neutron, like pencil beam in case of low accretion, or fan beam in case of high rate accretion. And this provide is possible to do with the X-ray polarimetry, because one can disentangle, one can compare the polarization degree as a function of phase with the intensity as a function of phase, and by comparing the two it's possible to disentangle the two regime of accretion on neutron stars. In magnetars, we try to search if vacuum birefringence is present. That is a long sought effect of quantum electrodynamics dating back in 1936. With XP, we can try to understand if the polarization is enough high to be explained only by the fact that this neutron star with a magnetic field large as 10 to the 15 Gauss polarize the vacuum and provide high level of polarization due to birefringence. In case of microquasars, we want to study if the is possible to derive the spin of a black hole by measuring the rotation of the polarization angle with respect to energy, that for a maximally rotating black hole is larger with respect to the non-rotating black hole. And this is an additional method with respect to the usual one to measure the spin of black hole. In case of blazar, we want to measure the polarization either in synchrotron dominated blazar and inverse Compton dominated blazar. And in a synchrotron dominated blazar, we can study the structure of the magnetic field. in the inverse Compton dominated blazar, the origin of seed photons can be studied in terms of synchrotron cell Compton or external Compton, depending if the polarization angle is as the same of the one of the synchrotron peak or is different from the one of the synchrotron peak. The data are being included in EASARC with a small, not completely yet, because of some issue in processing the data from the mock. And however, the expectation is that in the first 3 months, the data will be available after 30 days, and after 3 months of the mission, the data will be available after 1 week. There is some delay, but things are improving, and so the data will be made public in the next future quite soon. This is the observing plan. We observed until now, we started with Cassei, we end up with observing different kind of sources. Some of them require, like the crab, to be accumulated in more than one chunk. This is because as a small mission, the memory on board is small, so the crab and, for example, Hercolix 1 was observed in more than one observation. At the present time, we are observing the Vela Pulsar for the second chunk of observation, and this is the observing plan until June 2022. The distribution of celestial sources in the galactic plane are mostly on the galactic plane. However, there are also observation of blazars at high galactic latitude. Regarding the results, most of the results are still debating within the topical working group, since there are possibly embargo in submitting papers. We cannot describe in details the result of each single sources, but by using the level one data that are level data of that don't have the aspect solution, so they provide a lower limit to the detection of a source, because the observation is dominated by the dithering. We can say that X-ray is functioning, because observing the crab, we end up with the same polarization degree that was measured back in the 80s by OSO 8 and more recently by Polar Light, and at the same level. However, we can claim that 5 of the 13 sources observed so far have a secure detection that can allow us to say that in average they are polarized. This means that when doing pulse phase resolved and energy resolved polarimetry, the polarization can also increase. These are for use 14-2+61, a magnetar, Hercule X1, the accreting neutron star, Markarian 501, that is a blazar, Vela Pulsar Wind Nebula e Crab Pulsar Wind Nebula. So as I finish here saying that X-ray is functionally nominally and began measuring the polarization of cosmic X-ray source. I finished here.